Anything else, Emily? Chinatown is a week from Saturday, and so I'm not sure if there's still spaces available. Check with us last week. I have done the Chinatown trip myself, and it's an amazing time. It's a wonderful, wonderful time. So I heartily recommend it. So today we move to talking about questions of identity, our topic, from the point of view of developmental psychology, which, you know, I don't know about you, but for me that's like, well, that's absolutely perfect and normal. We look at identity from many perspectives. Obviously, psychology is a hugely important one. Our speaker today is Dr. Wendy Ostroff, who's one of my closest peers of colleagues. We've known each other for a long time, we have to come stay. And she is an extremely highly respected faculty member in the Hutchinson School of Rural Studies. Her PhD and MA are in the field of developmental psychology, I think, right? And specifically children's developmental psychology, right? She has written some really important books in the topic. Her most current one is called, it's about cultivating curiosity, K-12 education, right? So that gives you a sense of what Dr. Ostroff is interested in. She's interested in learning how we human beings come to learn, come to develop who we are. So that's their approach. And so please give a very, very warm welcome to Dr. Wendy Ostroff.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can everyone hear me? Okay, so I'm going to try something very different for this conversation today. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you some images. My entire presentation has almost no words at all. It's almost all images. And while we're doing that, I want to bring up some stories. I want to bring up some research. I want to bring up some of the knowledge and kind of the state of the art from a perspective of psychology and developmental science. So first off, the question that's going to kind of permeate this whole discussion and maybe permeate your entire semester is, who are you and how do you become who you are? How did you get to who you are and where are you going to go from here? This is a picture of me when I was in first grade, and I wanted to use this image to tell you that who you are is in flux. It's changing. There is not one cell in my body that's the same as it was when I was 6 years old in first grade all those years ago. And the cells in your body are constantly, as a physical self, regenerating themselves. The lining in your stomach has completely different cells within 5 days. Your entire epidermis, your entire skin is replaced just about every 2 weeks. All the cells in your bones within 10 years are going to be completely different cells, and the same with most of the cells in your brain that are constantly growing more cells, constantly pruning back cells. There are certain times in your life when this happens at more increased rates, and you're actually at one of those times. The time of the late teens and early 20s is in a time of incredible brain growth that you're in the midst of right now. So it's a really exciting time to think about and talk about the questions of who you are. So here's a human brain, and for most of our the last 100 years, and when we've learned so much about the brain, we've thought of the brain as being static, as being something that you hurt your brain cells and they're gone, or you do things and you have a good nutrition and good development and you're set. But now we're learning, as we have increased technology, to actually see the brain functioning in real time. We have all kinds of different ways of looking at the brain and having people interact in the world and actually seeing what's happening on the level of the brain. See, up until about 10 years ago, you had to be perfectly still for a scientist to access what was happening in your brain. So many of the things were seen as kind of a black box we didn't really understand. And like Scott said, I'm really interested in learning, how you learn. So things like fMRI, blood flow to different parts of the brain, have now been able to show us what's happening when you're thinking about something, what's happening when you're learning about something. And what we're finding is it's not just babies' brains that are changing and growing at an incredible rate. Even adults, like all of us in this room, all of us, our brains are always, always adapting to what we're doing. So I want to ask you to first do a little quick experiment. I want you to take your foot, your right foot, and I want you to rotate it clockwise. Everyone do that? Move your foot clockwise in circles. Get your circles going. You got it? Okay, now I want you to take that same hand, probably your right hand, and I want you to make a number six. Keep your foot going. Can you do it? Okay, if you do that for 10 minutes a day for a week, you'll have no problem doing that because you will have rearranged the motor cortex neurons of your brain. And it's just the same with the things that feel really difficult at first, like learning an instrument. How many people have ever tried to learn an instrument? And learning an instrument is really hard because you have to actually rewire your brain. And there's this very painful time at the beginning of learning where you feel like, and that's when most people quit, when you feel like there's no way I'm gonna get past this awful feeling. It's not working. And if you hang in there, you reach a point where you jump up, where your brain has actually reorganized and it starts to come naturally. You've forged new pathways. So some of the research on the brain came from work with monkeys. And this important work was started probably 20, 25 years ago at UCSF was one of the places in San Francisco that really championed this research. A man named Michael Merzenich was looking at how the motor cortex, how set is the motor cortex? Because it used to be thought that once you're an adult, you're set. You can't teach an old dog new tricks, right? So what he did with monkeys was he had them using their hands in the ways that they do, and then had monkeys' fingers tied together. So this little guy, two of his fingers would have been tied together. And then he uses that as a single digit. So he has to eat, he might have it tied together for an hour, and while he has to eat, he has to keep those two fingers together. And what Merzenich and his colleagues found was that within hours, not just the babies, but even the adults, the motor cortex, the map of the brain, of the fingers, reorganized to allow for three rather than four digits. So brains are not set. So everything you do, brains are constantly moving. You may have heard this statement that's kind of a myth or a urban legend that we only use 5% of our brains or we only use 10% of our brains. That's totally not true. We always use 100% of our brains because any part of our brains that we don't use, those neurons are pruned. The brain is the most efficient organ in your body. Everything that you're doing is affecting the way that your brain is functioning. And so some of this research has also been done with owls and owls' visual systems. So owls have an extremely precise visual system. They have to fly through the air and be able to find food from way high up, and then they have to be able to dive down and catch something and to be able to get it. Well, what they did in these studies was they put glasses on the owls, sounds kind of funny, that made the whole world upside down. The entire world looked upside down for them. And again, within less than an hour, these owls were able to completely, their brains completely reorganized to adapt to the world in an upside down world. And then take the glasses off and then they're back to the world as it is. So it's just to let us know that if we feel that who we are is fixed, it's so far from the truth in what the brain science is showing us. Now, the last part of the brain that has evolved in humans and the last part of the brain that's developing for each one of you is the prefrontal cortex. That's the part right here. That's the part of your brain that you use to do really complex things and the kinds of things that you're doing here since you've come to college. Things like critical thinking, really thinking something through and really understanding the nuances. Things like holding back. When you want to say something, but you don't say it. You have to hold back, making those kinds of fine decisions to decide, you know, do you stick your foot in your mouth or, you know, do you hold back? Do you say it? Do you not say it? Planning, complex planning. You now as college students, you have a whole week that you have to decide what to do with, right? You're not in class from 8 a.m. till 2 or 3 p.m. You might have classes scattered here and there. You might have whole days without classes at all. You have to figure out when you're gonna get your homework done. You have to figure out how you're gonna let your social life be part of your life, how you're gonna prioritize. These are incredibly complex skills that take you out of the here and now. And those are all prefrontal cortex skills. And your prefrontal cortex, the latest studies are showing that it's not fully developed till you're in your mid-20s. So not till 25 or 26 do you have those kinds of skills to make to make reasoned choices and to be critical thinkers and to be on. And there's something really important that we're going to talk about in a few minutes. So hold that in mind, that this planning brain, this executive function, they call it, the things that, it's like the CEO of the brain that decides what has to happen when, how it has to happen, all that nuance, all that subtlety is actually still developing, very much in flux. So now I want to go back a little bit and talk about the development of who you are, your identity. How did you become you? And I want to talk about this thing that they do to all newborn babies in this country that are born in hospitals, all have a heel stick, a heel prick. They poke their heel, it's usually done on the first or second day of life, and they test their blood for genetic diseases, and this is a public health thing that we've had since the 70s, where babies are tested and screened for all kinds of things like PKU and sickle cell anemia and genetic diseases that we can do something about so that we know in advance how to help these babies. But what happens is when babies are given the heel stick, it's a needle, they poke their, they prick their heel, they squeeze the blood, and then they put the blood on a little card and they test it. What do you think the babies do? They cry. They scream. This is the first real pain that most babies have had at all. They've just been born yesterday. They were born yesterday. And they really do scream. But what researchers have done is really interesting. They've been there and looked at, okay, every baby screams. But some of the babies, it takes a long time after screaming for them to come back down, back to baseline, back to, okay, I'm okay. And some babies, it takes twice or three times as long for them to feel okay after that unexpected pain that they had. And what they find is that those characteristic responses, those biological responses, that's the autonomic nervous system. That's the way that we still have that now. We have differences in your autonomic nervous system. So you might be, if you're really stressed, you're really freaking out, everything's awful, what do you do to calm yourself down? Anyone? Someone say? What do you do? Sleep? You can sleep? You're freaking out? You can go right to sleep? Some people are good at that. Yeah. Go for a drive. Yeah, get out of there, right? Right? Is there something in the moment, like if right now you are just, you're stressed, you're sweating, you feel awful, is there something you could do right here in your chair? You could cry? You could have a release? Yeah. Deep breaths, totally. It's not possible to keep your autonomic nervous system aroused, high stress, it's not possible after 10 deep breaths. If you take 10 deep breaths, you cannot physically stay stressed. So that's good to know, we have that. That's called self-regulation. We have ways to take our nervous systems and regulate them and get them back down to that baseline. Babies tend to be born already with different ways of regulating their arousal. And most of the first couple years of life, they depend on their caregivers to do that for them because it's very, very hard for them to soothe themselves. They need someone, and caregivers use their voices to soothe babies. So caregivers say things like, it's okay. And they rock them back and forth. So they use a vestibular stimulation. They use a falling tone to let them know it's time to calm down. And caregivers also let babies know when it's time to get excited. Let's go for a walk. You go up, sweeps up, let you know that it's time to get excited. It's time to let your nervous system get excited. But in these cases, they follow these babies. They found that a small amount of babies, about 10 to 15% of those babies, had a really hard time, even with someone soothing them, even with someone talking gently and rocking them. It just took them twice as long, three times as long to just be okay after being poked like that. So what was going on with those kids? Well, they followed those kids and they brought them back into the lab when they were just about 2 years old. And they showed, and they also got the kids on the other extreme. The newborn babies who after the heel stick, almost immediately, they were so good at just coming back to calm. So quickly, they were okay, they were totally fine. They brought those kids in too, the high and the low end. And they brought them into the lab and they gave them these kind of unusual experiences. One was this robot and the smoke came out of its mouth and ears and it moved erratically and they put the the two-year-old's on the floor and they all of a sudden they're playing and all of a sudden this crazy robot comes in. So it's a little bit like, oh, it's a little jarring. And some kids that went towards the robot and were just curious and wanted to check out the robot. And some kids, that robot really freaked them out and they just wanted to get away from that robot and they just wanted to get out of that situation. And what was fascinating was it was the same kids that had a hard time calming themselves after the getting physically hurt that also were a little bit more inhibited around that robot. And then they followed them later in life, and they followed them now. I mean, these studies were started, these kids are in their 30s and 40s now, and they've still been following these same people to see what happened in their lives. And this is just a, you don't need to understand this graph, but just to let you know that the high reactive and the low reactive kids had very different brain activity when they saw them, and that continued throughout their lives. So there was something going on with the way their nervous system and their brain was organized, where extreme situations were very difficult and were causing a reaction that was characteristically different in their brain and in their sympathetic tone, their nervous system, to let them know. So that's all to tell you that we come into the world with a kind of reactivity that could affect who we become. Those people who had high reactivity right from the day they were born, at 18 and 20 and 25 and 30 were much more introverted people. And they were much more in strange situations and social situations. It took them a while longer. They were slow to warm up kind of people. They were maybe more sensitive, maybe more perceptive. They were the kind of people that they weren't going to be, you know, immediately in the middle of the party, but maybe they were going to have a really intense conversation with one person over on the side of the party. And those are about 15% of the population that were biologically organized quite differently than other people. Now, I was telling you before about the prefrontal cortex, and I want to come back to that because the prefrontal cortex is, this is a different image of the brain, but right in the middle of the brain is the amygdala, and that's very different than the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex, as I said, was the last thing to evolve in humans, and it's the last thing to develop in you. The amygdala is something that's been around for a long time. The amygdala, most animals have an amygdala system, even very simple animals that don't have critical thinking, that don't have reasoning, but they do have that. The amygdala is where we process those really, really fundamental emotional responses, the fight or flight. So if a predator is coming, then, you know, if a tiger comes through that door, then your amygdala is going to start getting blood flow. It's going to start firing. And you're going to get, suddenly, you're going to go into survival mode. You're going to kind of downshift into the way that humans and other animals have handled stress and danger. You're going to want to get out of here. You're going to start sweating. Your pupils are going to dilate, so you're going to be able to get more of a sense of what's going on. Your breathing is going to speed up. Your heart's going to start pounding. You're going to be ready to either fight or run to get away from that predator. But what I want to tell you, which I think is really important, is some recent evidence that the amygdala is kind of the superhighway. And if you're on the amygdala track, if you're in that stressed mode, it's almost impossible to use your prefrontal cortex. It's almost impossible to do the critical thinking and the nuance and the, because who has time, right? All your resources are going in. You got to get out of there. You've got to survive. And so a recent study that came out showed that when students are stressed, they cannot use the kind of critical thinking brain that they need to use to do things like be successful in college. And one of the top stressors of adolescents and young adults, can anyone guess? What's stressful for adolescents and young adults? School is stressful, but even on top of that, even more specific, what they found is that boredom is stressful. If you are bored, if you're sitting in a big lecture right now and you're right now bored with what I'm saying, you're gonna start to feel stress. You're gonna start to feel like, oh my God, I'm bored. I gotta get out of here. I'm sweating. I gotta check my phone. I wanna nervously do something else. I gotta start self-regulating. I gotta doodle. Doodling's a great one. You can self-regulate. my breathing's increasing. This is awful. This is torture, right? Doesn't boredom feel like torture? If you're sitting for hours and someone's droning for hours, that's torture to us. So what happens is you're switching into amygdala mode. If you're bored, you're not going to be able to think. So when you're sitting passively and not interacting in a classroom, that's why so many, the tradition of the person up on the stage for longer than just a little something interesting is gonna be torturous. 3 hours of lecture droning on is gonna be awful for you because you can't even think straight. And there's a biological reason why you can't think straight. You're in amygdala mode. You're in fight or flight. You're either gonna start, if you're in first grade, you're gonna start throwing spitballs. You're gonna start pulling someone's hair. You're gonna do anything to get out of that space. That's a flight. That's a flight from concentration. You're not gonna be able to concentrate in that state. So I think that's really powerful for how we teach and how we learn to know and understand that about the brain. Something else I wanna put, so we're kind of building, it's like puzzle pieces of who you are and how you get to be who you are. I wanna talk for a minute about self-recognition. When do you know who you are? When does a baby see herself in the mirror and know, that's me? Well, they've done a lot of research on this, and babies are fascinated by their own reflection, by the way, almost right away. For as soon as they can hold their heads up, they will be fascinated. But in order, in developmental science, they can't talk, so you have to find creative ways to understand, how do they know it's them? So what they started doing is this, what they call the rouge test. You can also do it with a post-it. You put a little dot of rouge or a little post-it or a little something on the child's, on them, and then put them in front of the mirror, and if they reach for themselves, they know it's them. They know that if they reach for their own body, then they know. And kids do this, one year old is pretty young. Between 12 and 18 months is around the time when they do it. By two, almost all kids, and it's been done in various cultures, it's been shown across cultures that kids, when shown a mirror, will reach for themselves at that age. So they know, they can recognize and know, hey, that's me. And how do they start to develop that sense of self, that self-concept? Well, one of the ways that kids start to do that, to develop who they are, is by something called schemas. So kids use schemas, which are kind of like stories of what's happening. So the schema, these kids are at the grocery store. What's the schema for the grocery store? Okay, we get the basket. And then we start putting the food in the basket. We go up and down the aisles. Every time we go to the grocery store, we do this. We get the basket, and mom or dad puts the bags from the car in the basket. Then we get in. We always start at the produce, or sometimes we start it over at the meat counter, and we go through, and here's what we say. We say, here, how are you? And then we put our groceries on the belt, and then the checkout person lets us know, and then we slide our card. And so they get these little patterns in their mind, and that helps them to predict what's coming next. And we have schemas for things too. We have a schema for this class. So you know what happens when you walk into an auditorium of a college class. You sit, you find a seat, you sit down, you take out your bag, you might take out your notebook, you might take out your pen. These little action patterns, these little pathways, they tell you what to do, how to behave. So as a baby and then a young child gets used to these schemas, they can predict what's coming next and how they play a role. So in a way, we're in a play, we're in our own play, the play of us, right? The play of your lives. But when you're first starting out in being you, someone else is letting you know how we play this, how do we play this game. Here's what we do. We do, this is what we do at school, this is what we do at the grocery store, this is what we do at the bank, and they let you know, this is how our culture works. These are the rules. You learn the rules very early on, and you learn how do you function, what character are you in that play. I want to tell you a little bit about a very famous neurologist named Oliver Sacks. He just passed away recently, but he had a prolific career as a researcher, as a writer, and Oliver Sacks studied everything about the brain, things that can go wrong or things that make you who you are. He worked with people that had amnesia, he worked with people that heard voices, he worked with all kinds, a huge range of unusual things that can happen in the brain. And Oliver Sacks himself wrote a few memoirs throughout his life. In one story, he was living in London. He was a little boy in London during World War II when the Blitz happened, when London was bombed during World War II. And in his first memoir, he wrote about that experience of seeing the white light and having to run in the house and having his brothers there and being scared and having there be rubble and things falling. And he wrote very vividly about that experience in the memoir. And after it was published, his brother read his first memoir, and his brother said, "You weren't there." So Oliver Sacks, who studied the brain and who studied memory and who studied identity and who studied neurology for, you know, 50 plus years, had an experience of what we call a false memory. He remembered it in vivid detail. And his older brother let him know, "You weren't there, but our older brother, David, was there, and we were away at school, but he wrote us a vivid letter describing exactly what happened." And that letter must, in your mind, have combined with, you know, our experience of our family and the photos to create in you a false memory. Now, if Oliver Sacks can have a false memory, boy, are we all vulnerable to things in our stories of ourselves, and including photos, including all those schemas. You know, we go to the grocery store and, you know, this is what we do on the holidays. So we have these images, we have these stories we're telling about who we are as we're going through our lives, but we're not always correct about what's happening to us. So how do memories get encoded? Well, storytelling has been a part of many cultures, and our ancestors throughout time have told stories. That's the way that humans have passed on meaning for the most part. And stories, like I said, stories become action patterns. So we tell stories and then we know what we're supposed to do. We know what role we're supposed to play in this, as this character in our lives. And we do it today. But what we do with children, and now there's a kind of a new little thread of research on this, is how do children get talked to about what happened? So when parents and children share an experience, or grandparents and children share an experience, we do this thing where we retell the stories in the way that we want to retell those stories, right? And so if you interview a four-year-old that went on a field trip to the aquarium and you say to them, "What did you see at the aquarium?" And they might talk about the railings. They might talk about, "We saw these red railings at the aquarium." And they might talk about the flag, and the flag was really big and it was really loud at the aquarium. But if mom or dad or grandpa or someone's there, they might say, "No, honey, you remember. We saw those sharks. You remember? You were scared of those sharks, but it was okay. We saw those sharks." And so caregivers tell the story for the child, and caregivers even do that in emotional situations, sometimes especially in emotional situations. So if you got really hurt and you felt, well, first off, when kids fall and get really hurt, they look up to their caregivers to make sure they're okay. "Am I okay?" And if the mom says, "Oh, honey," then they burst into tears and it's just terrible. But if the caregiver says, "Oh, here we go, come on," then they jump up and get on, because other people let us know. They let us know what we're supposed to feel, and they let us know what we're supposed to do, and they let us know how we're supposed to remember. And in fact, the most well-meaning caregivers and parents and grandparents are telling stories that fit in with their idea of themselves as a character and their idea of their child, right? So if your child, if you just spent $80 to take the family to the aquarium and all the kids remember are the railings, or all the kids remember is the bus ride, then that might be considered a waste of time, might be considered a waste of money. You have to let them know, "No, we saw this and we saw that, and you enjoyed this and you did that, and you're fine, you're not upset." We parents and caregivers tell us how we feel, they tell us what we're doing, they lead us along. They're the directors of our plays, until suddenly we find ourselves in new situations, like at away at university, and we don't know what we're doing yet, and we follow our schemas until we start to tell our own stories. This is Elizabeth Loftus. She's probably the premier psychologist researcher in memory ever. I mean, she's the most commonly brought into courtroom trials that are concerning memory and false memories. She did the pioneering work way back where they implanted false memories into people. They told children that they even told adults that when you were a child, you were lost in a mall, and you were very scared, and here's what happened, and the security guard helped you. They told very elaborate stories, and the adults believe that that happened to them. They claim to remember very lots of specifics about these things that were not never happened, that weren't true. It's very easy to do. I've done it with students here at Sonoma State. I've taught a class on memory, and I've had someone come in at the beginning of class and steal the computer right out of the classroom, and everyone was there, everyone saw the person, and then I asked leading questions, like what color hat was he wearing, and you know, students will swear that he was wearing a hat, they'll argue about red and blue hats when he wasn't even wearing a hat. So it's very easy to convince people of different memories. It's very easy when you look back at your photos of a trip to change your perspective on what happened on the trip, what it actually felt like, having come, you know, through the experience to what their memory of the experience. And Elizabeth Loftus says that we think memory works like a recording device. It's very different than a recording device. It's more like a Wikipedia page. You can go in there and change it. And we often do. And others can also go in there and change it. So telling stories to children is essentially smoothing their memories to fit our stories in a way, the stories that we tell. So now I want to tell you about some work. Well, first I want to ask you a question. If you were going to take a vacation, and you could take a vacation anywhere in the world, it's going to be 2 weeks. You get to do whatever you want. It's all expenses paid. Okay, so just imagine that. This is a little thought experiment. You got, just think in your mind, where would you, I don't know if you'd like to go there or somewhere else. Just take a second and imagine the place where you're going to go, okay, for that time period. Now, here are the rules, though. Here are the only rules. The only rules are that at the end of the 2 weeks, we're going to destroy any photographic evidence. There's not going to be any photographs or any recordings of any kind that happened. Okay? And number two, you're going to be given an amnesic drug, and so you're not going to remember it afterwards. You're not going to remember the experience at all. But you had it. You went there, and you enjoy those 2 weeks. Does that change where you want to go? It does? You want to go somewhere else? Or what you want to do? Does it change what you want to do while you're there? What they found when they asked people these questions is that people completely changed what they wanted to do and how they wanted to do it if they weren't going to remember. Because oftentimes we have an experiencing self that's in the moment, but we also have a remembering self that's doing things. And our culture really, and especially now, with the way that we're recording so many things, we're capturing so many things with our devices, we are a culture that spends a lot more time in the remembering self than we do in the experiencing self. So we're doing a lot of creating our identities. We're creating who we want to be and who we are by narrating our lives. We're narrating using photos, we're narrating using recounting, we're narrating using nostalgia. So we're already, before we're taking the vacation, we're already anticipating how we're going to remember the vacation in this arc of who we are, in this novel that we're essentially writing as we're living. And we're very social creatures. We are humans. We've developed over tens of thousands of years in social situations. So it really, we take on the experiences of those that are around us. And the way that our brains operate and the way we become who we are is a two-way arrow, right? So it's not just I do these things in the world and that's who I am. There's another feedback. What I do in the world, it's not just you come with a brain and then your brain leads you to do those things. It's that the things that you do go back and change your brain and who you are. So depending on what kinds of situations socially you're in, you're going to do different things. Now, there's, I think, some really fascinating research that's coming out on collaborative learning. How do we learn together? And what do we do with each other to influence not just our stories of ourselves, but what we do on the ground? How do we influence each other's learning? In these studies, what they did was they asked kids to work together to solve complex problems. So in some cases, they had to use the materials that they had to build something. and to be successful, and there was going to be a series of problems that they had to solve along the way, and these are elementary age kids. So the researchers had them go through the problem-solving process together, and then they separated the kids, and they interviewed them and asked them, what was your idea? Was that your idea to put the wings over there on that rocket ship? Was that who thought of standing it on end before putting this cardboard on top? Who thought of that? And what they found was that the kids often take credit for things they didn't do. They say, "Oh, that was me. That was my idea. I did that." And then the other kid said that was their idea too, right? And so everybody, they say, "Well, wait, who put the flag on the top of the rocket ship?" "So I did that. That was me. I did it." And the other kid says, "Oh yeah, I did that. I did that too." What they found is when the kids are focused on problem solving together in this collaborative, intense environment, they began to blur. They didn't know anymore who. They weren't just trying to be egomaniacs and take credit. They no longer knew who did what. They actually couldn't remember and couldn't tell what they were doing and what the other person was doing. It's called the I did it bias, where kids tend to take credit. And I think a lot of adults do that too. If you do group projects, maybe that comes out. But when we take credit for someone else, we're actually activating these very particular kinds of neurons in our brain called mirror neurons. There are neurons in your brain that fire when you watch someone else doing something very intently with the intention to do it. And so in a way, what that's doing, what our brains are doing, is you can seep in, you can gain the experience of someone else simply by being with them and being connected and collaborating in a very intense way. So we're doing this all the time. You're getting the benefit of having done it yourself. And the first studies were discovered with monkeys. So what they found is that when the monkey, you know, holds the banana and starts to peel it, or the monkey's just sitting there looking at the banana about to do it, to the brain it was no different, which is an incredible adaptation, right? Because you don't have to do everything yourself in order to get the benefit. You can simply work with other people and other humans and gain that knowledge just by being with them, just by being in that collaborative space. There's a really beautiful and elegant study that was done a few years back with piano playing. So what they did in that study was they had two groups of people come in that had never played the piano. One group came into the lab and learned a five-finger piano exercise, a little tune with one hand. And then they were asked to practice that, just like I had you do the foot thing. You know, they had them do it, something very awkward to try and play the piano when you've never played before. And they had them go home over the next 2 weeks and just practice 10 minutes a day. And then they brought them back in. The second group, though, just watched. They had them come in and watch someone doing the five-finger piano exercise and really focus. And then they had those people just come into the same room for 10 minutes a day with the grand piano sitting there and just imagine themselves doing the five-finger exercise. When they brought them back at the end of 2 weeks, there was absolutely no difference in their brains, what they looked like, and there was no difference in the way they played. Both groups were able to play the exercise just as well, and their brains looked the same. So the power, we're just starting to understand the power of mirror neurons for learning and learning collaboratively, and that, I think, has a huge impact on how we look at who we are, because it's not so solid anymore, who we are. Who we are is very much affected by our social situations, by our social stories, and by the things we do. And I want to show you just a 10-minute, to finish up the talk, I want to show you a 10-minute, one of those animate videos, just to take you through that point, to understand the mirror neurons and to understand what effect that really has on our culture and who we are and our identities within that culture. So Scott's going to cue that up. It is, yes.
In the last 10 years, there's been some very interesting developments in evolutionary biology, neurocognitive science, child development research, and many other fields, which is beginning to challenge some of these long-held shibboleths that we've had about human nature and the meaning of the human journey. But there is another frame of reference emerging in the sciences, which is quite interesting. It really challenges these assumptions. And with that, the institutions that we have created based on those assumptions, our educational institutions, our business practices, our governing institutions, etc. Let me take you back to the early 1990s, sleepy little laboratory in Parma, Italy, and scientists had a MRI brain scanning machine on a macaque monkey as the macaque monkey was trying to open up a nut. They wanted to see how the neurons would light up. So the monkey's trying to open up the nut, the neurons light up. And just by serendipity, and this is how science sometimes happens, a human being walked into the laboratory, I don't know if it was by mistake, and he was hungry, he saw the nuts and opened up one of the nuts and tried to crack it open. The macaque monkey was totally shocked because who was this invader in his laboratory? And he didn't move. He just gazed at this human trying to open up the nut, just like he had done a few seconds earlier. And then the scientist looked on the MRI brain scanner. The same exact neurons were lighting up when he observed the human being opening the nut as when the monkey opened the nut. And the scientists had not a clue as to what this was. They thought the MRI machine had broken. They then began to put MRI brain scanning machines on other primates, especially chimpanzees with our big neocortex. Then they went to humans, and what they found over and over again is something called mirror neurons. And that is that we are apparently soft-wired, some of the primates, all humans. We suspect elephants. We're not sure about dolphins and dogs. We've just begun. But all humans are soft-wired with mirror neurons so that if I'm observing you, your anger, your frustration, your sense of rejection, your joy, whatever it is, and I can feel what you're doing, the same neurons will light up in me as if I'm having that experience myself. Now, this isn't all that unusual. We know if a spider goes up someone's arm and I'm observing it going up your arm, I'm going to get a creepy feeling. We take this for granted, but we are actually softwired to actually experience another's plight as if we are experiencing ourselves. But mirror neurons are just the beginning of a whole range of research going on in neuropsychology and brain research and in child development that suggests that we are actually soft-wired not for aggression and violence and self-interest and utilitarianism, that we are actually soft-wired for sociability, attachment, as John Bowlby might have said, affection, companionship, and that the first drive is the drive to actually belong. It's an empathic drive. What is empathy? It's very complicated. When little babies are in a nursery and one baby cries, the other babies will cry in response. They just don't know why. That's empathic distress. It's built into their biology. Around 2.5 years of age, a child actually can begin to recognize himself in a mirror. That's when you begin to mature empathy as a cultural phenomenon. And that is once a toddler can identify themselves, then they know that if they're observing someone else have a feeling, they know that if they feel something, it's because they're feeling it because someone else has it. They're two separate beings. Selfhood goes together with empathic development. Increasing selfhood, increasing empathic development. Around 8 years of age, a child learns about birth and death. They learn where they came from, that they have a one and only life, that life is fragile and vulnerable, and one day they're going to die. That's the beginning of an existential trip. Because when a child learns about birth and death and they have a one and only life, they realize how fragile and vulnerable life is. It's very tough being alive on this planet, whether you're a human being or a fox navigating the forest. So when a child learns that life is vulnerable and fragile and that every moment is precious and that they have their own unique history, it allows the child then to experience another's plight in the same way, that that other person or other being, could be another creature, has a one and only life. It's tough to be alive, and the odds are not always good. So if you think about the times that we've empathized with each other or fellow creatures, it's always because we felt their struggle. We have the whiff of death in empathy and the celebration of life. And we show solidarity with our compassion. Empathy is the opposite of utopia. There is no empathy in heaven. I guarantee you, I'll tell you before you get there. There isn't any empathy in heaven because there's no mortality. There's no empathy in utopia because there is no suffering. Empathy is grounded in the acknowledgement of death and the celebration of life and rooting for each other to flourish and be. It's based on our frailties and our imperfections. So when we talk about building an empathic civilization, we're not talking about utopia. We're talking about the ability of human beings to show solidarity, not only with each other, but our fellow creatures who have a one and only life on this little planet. We are homo empathicus. So here's the question. We know that consciousness changes in history. The way our brain is wired today is not the way a medieval serf's brain would be wired, and their brain wouldn't be the same as the wiring of a forager hunter 30,000 years ago. So the question I asked at the beginning of this study 6 years ago is, how does consciousness change in history? Because I wanted to imagine the following proposition. Is it possible that we human beings who are softwired for empathic distress, is it possible we could actually extend our empathy to the entire human race as an extended family and to our fellow creatures as part of our evolutionary family and to the biosphere as our common community? If it's possible to imagine that, then we may be able to save our species and save our planet. And what I say to you tonight, if it's impossible to even imagine that, I don't see how we're going to make it. Empathy is the invisible hand. Empathy is what allows us to stretch our sensibility with another so that we can cohere in larger social units. To empathize is to civilize. To civilize is to empathize. With forager hunter societies, communication only extended to the local tribe and shouting distance. Everyone over in the next mountain was the alien other. So empathy only extended to blood ties. When we went to the great hydraulic agricultural civilization, script allowed us to extend the central nervous system and to annihilate more time and space and bring more people together. And the differentiation of skills and the increasing selfhood not only led to theological consciousness, but empathy now extended to a new fiction. And that is, instead of just associating with one's blood ties, we detribalized and began association based on religious ties. So a new fiction, Jews start to see all other Jews as extended family and empathize with Jews. Christians start to see all other Christians as extended family and empathize with Christians. Muslims, the same. When we get to the 19th century, the Industrial Revolution, and we extend markets now to larger areas and create a fiction called the nation state. And all of a sudden, the Brits start to see others in Britain as extended family. The Germans start to see Germans as extended family, the Americans as Americans. There was no such thing as Germany. There was no such thing as France. These are fictions. But they allow us to extend our family so that we can have loyalties and identities based on the new complex energy communication revolutions we have that annihilate time and space. But if we have gone from empathy in blood ties to empathy in religious associational ties, to empathy based on national identification, is it really a big stretch to imagine the new technologies allowing us to connect our empathy to the human race writ large in a single biosphere? And what reason would we stop here at the nation-state identity and only have ideological empathy or theological-based empathy or tribal-based blood-tie empathy? We have the technology that allows us to extend the central nervous system and to think viscerally as a family, not just intellectually. When that earthquake hit Haiti and then Chile, but especially Haiti, within an hour, the Twitters came out, and within 2 hours, some cell phone videos, YouTube, and within 3 hours, the entire human race was in an empathic embrace coming to the aid of Haiti. If we were, as the Enlightenment philosopher suggested, in materialistic, self-interested, utilitarian, pleasure-seeking, it couldn't account for the response to Haiti. Apparently, 175,000 years ago in the Rift Valley of Africa, there were about 10,000 anatomically modern human beings walking the grasslands, our ancestors. The geneticists located one database woman. It's a database line. Apparently, her genes passed to everyone in this room tonight. The other ladies didn't make it. Gets even more strange. They located a single male. This is a database line for genetics. They call him the Y chromosome Adam. Apparently, a fairly potent guy. His genes passed to everyone in this room. So here's the news. 6.8 billion people at various stages of consciousness, theological, ideological, psychological, dramaturgical, we're all fighting with each other with different ideas about the world. And guess what? We all came from two people. The Bible got this one right. We could have come from many. But the point is, we have to begin thinking as an extended family. We have to broaden our sense of identity. We don't lose the old identities of nationhood and our religious identities, and even our blood ties. But we extend our identity so we can think of the human race as our fellow sojourners and our other creatures here as part of our evolutionary family and the biosphere as our community. We have to rethink the human narrative. If we are truly homo empathicus, then we need to bring out that core nature. Because if it doesn't come out and it's repressed by our parenting, our educational system, our business practice and government, the secondary drives come. The narcissism, the materialism, the violence, the aggression. if we can have a global debate, let it start here from the British Royal Society for the Arts, which apparently you're doing, to begin rethinking human nature, to bring out our empathic sociability so that we can rethink the institutions of society and prepare the groundwork for an empathic civilization.
I know. I know that's a lot to take in, and I know we've gone from the very tiny to the way your nervous system is functioning to the very broad. But the one message is that who you are is in flux, and who you are is bigger than just the walls of your physical body. Who you are is a connected being in the developmental sense, in the evolutionary sense, in the social sense. Who we are is something that we have quite a lot of control over, and something that we can work together with others and work well together. So thank you.